Well, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Teresa Wupaw, and I'm the chairperson of the Canadian Race Relations Foundation. I would like to welcome all who are joining us from across the country for what I'm sure will be an exciting and an enlightening discussion. But before we go further, I'm speaking to you from Treaty 7 territory, the traditional territories of the Blackfoot Nations, including Siksika, Piikani, Kainai, Tsuut'ina Nation, and Stoney Nakoda First Nations. We acknowledge all the many First Nations, Métis, and Inuit whose footsteps have marked these lands for centuries. Anti-Asian racism is an issue that is a major concern for all Asian Canadians and should be a concern for all Canadians. Unfortunately, we have been there before. Whether it is the propaganda of stereotypes such as the Yellow Peril that was spread at the turn of the century when thousands of Asian first arrived on Canadian shores, or who actually wrote me a letter to call me the Yellow Peril when I first got elected in Calgary. And so it continues to play out in various ways in Canadians' life today. Or other racial constructs, such as the model minority, that are either said directly or inferred in news stories. Throughout history, we have been inundated with news about the pandemic of racism. Today, we'll examine how the media may or may not have played a role in the escalation of the recent spike in anti-Asian hate. I would like to take this opportunity to thank our generous webinar sponsor, Toyota Canada, for their collaboration and support to communities. Next, we would like to kick off the webinar by showing you a short 2-minute video produced by the ACT Foundation and Asian Canadians Together to End Racism. After which, I'll hand over the mic to today's moderator, Alex Nguyen, a talented young journalist from British Columbia.
Have an awesome day.
Thanks.
Hi. Can I get a large hot chocolate, please?
I have to clean it.
It's not what you think it is.
Don't freak out.
Calm down.
That's not a big deal.
And then his girlfriend on the back of the motorcycle yelled at me, shut up, you captain chick.
That's not okay.
Don't take it.
Are you just gonna
just
stand there?
More than making a scene, it's just a joke.
Let them treat you that way.
It's not what you think it is. I'm worried about that. That's not me. He's just speaking up.
Stand up to yourself.
Don't worry about it. This is not the reason.
You've got to do something. That's not right. I'm not
too saying that. Don't let go of your shoulder.
All right, I guess it's time for the discussion. So hello everyone, I am Alex, I'm based in Vancouver, and today joining me is documentary filmmaker Karen Cho, journalist Avin Joaquin and Ryerson Dean of Faculty of Arts Pam Sugiman. And just a quick note, if you have any questions, please post them in the Q&A chat box and we'll get to them at the end of the discussions. And also before we jumped into the discussions that we have today, I just want to make a quick note that, you know, the Asian Canadian identity covers so many different groups and ethnicities. And obviously based on our panel, we don't cover every single group of them. For example, South Asian Canadian identities cover so many diversity as well. But today we would like to focus on the lived experience and expertise of East Asians and Southeast Asian Canadians, especially because the recent wave of hate crimes have disproportionately affected these groups. So that's just something that we want to lay the foundation for before our discussion today. So yeah, let's jump right into it. So as you can all see from the video, anti-Asian racism is not new in Canada. And I guess my first questions for our panelists. So from, you know, what have you seen as the media's role in perpetuating, you know, that narrative of the perpetual foreigner, model minority, or yellow peril over the course of our history?
Well, maybe I'll begin because I'm the oldest one here, I think, on the panel, and have lived through some of the history. I think the media has certainly played a strong role in perpetuating these, racist ideas and racist stereotypes in particular. I think it's important to mention also that these ideas that are perpetuated through the media are also embedded in other institutions. So, you know, in a generated and perpetuated in the context of institutional racism. So we find discrimination, for example, in employment and throughout history, looking back at the Chinese head tax, various forms of discrimination in immigration policy within this country, the internment of Japanese Canadians, which is of particular importance and meaning to me and my family. So these ideas are all rooted in a long history of institutional racism.
Yeah, well, I mean, I guess to continue with that, I mean, as Pam had mentioned, I mean, the very beginnings of our history in this country stem from racism, right? And these kind of systemic barriers that have always been perpetuate themselves through the stories we tell, or, you know, the narrative we build around, you know, who is Canada, what does a Canadian look like, and this kind of colonialist narrative that really celebrates the history of, you know, folks coming from the Atlantic, this kind of Eurocentric history of the country versus folks coming from the Pacific, and let alone the Aboriginal folks who were here first. So this kind of, you know, boils down into a lot of the kind of myth making and storytelling of the country, which filters into the media, and we see it here today in the modern day. You know, when we talk about Asians, there was two instances, but there's the very, very famous W5 campus giveaway story. It was something that actually sparked the, you know, the beginning of the CCNC and the kind of Chinese movement or Chinese Canadian movement, but it was basically a news story that questioned whether or not our university campuses are getting taken over by the Chinese, you know, and let alone the fact that half the folks in that news story and the images in the news story were Chinese born. They were Canadian born. They happened to be Asian, but they were Canadians, right? And then 30 years later, McLean does the same story, you know, two Asian story. So these kind of, you know, histories perpetuate themselves over and over, and we see a lot. And especially in the coverage now with the pandemic, these kind of racist constructs of you know, the yellow peril coming, you know, with the coronavirus and this idea that we're perpetually foreigners, right? You know, constantly showing folks in Asians in masks and in all of the coverage, stock shots of Chinatown and all of the coverage, signaling that even though we've been here several generations, but we still don't belong.
I can jump in. Really important points by Pam and Karen. And I just want to add from Karen's point that whatever's happening in the institution, it filters through the media. Because I'd like to think of the media as both a mirror and a hammer. It is reflecting what is happening in society, but at the same time, I think we also have to acknowledge that the media has the opportunity to shatter the norm and reshape narratives. As mentioned by my co-panelists, most North American representations of Asian people are rooted in stereotypes, institutional racism, and long history of racist narratives. But at the same time, I think various media slowly gives opportunity to critique and reflection, and in some ways trying to reshape the narratives, just like the video we just watched.
Yeah, no, I completely agree, Arvin. Like, I mean, I come from a bit of a different background because I'm a documentary filmmaker. So in a way I see myself as, it's storytelling and it's media, but, I feel I also have a duty to it's a famous expression, but, our duty is not just to tell the story, but it's to change the story. And the way you change the story is by giving that extra analysis and asking those hard questions. Like, why are we equating these images to this stereotype? Why are we not asking more difficult questions about the kind of systemic things behind some of these headlines and the attitudes behind some of this reporting? So the media, as you say, like there's two aspects. You can perpetuate the stereotypes, or you can really challenge them and try to change them.
And I think, on that point, I would say that an important distinction be made between traditional media and social media. And I would think that Karen and Arvin are more familiar with social media than I. But these ideas were instilled in many of us, learned by many of us, my generation through the traditional media, print media, for example, lots of headlines that you've just seen in newspapers. And magazines and entertainment in film and TV. But now I think that these narratives these racist narratives almost take on a life of their own when they are expressed in social media. Because more and more people, it's not just a journalist, for example, or a filmmaker, conveying a certain image of an Asian Canadian, but everyone out there who's on social media can contribute to that, the perpetuation of those racist images.
Mm-hmm. Right, for sure. And yeah, I think from our just brief discussion so far, it seems like there's so much room and space for, Canadian media and journalism to improve on our coverage. And I guess with that, let's, jump into right into it. How do we improve our coverage? How do we ensure that the history we just laid out is more integrated into our framing? So that every conversations we have about anti-Asian racism doesn't have to start at the very beginning again.
Well, I mean, I think from us, especially in this period, racism is not new. Anti-Asian racism didn't just happen with this pandemic, but we're really living in this moment where so much of the coverage, especially at the very beginning of the pandemic, really failed to differentiate Asian Canadians or Chinese folks in Canada from the country China, right? So a lot of the coverage, and then characterizing the thing as the China virus, the Kung Flu, all of that set a tone, right? So after that, of course, all our Chinatowns got targeted, these images here you're seeing, this one in particular, this is my Chinatown, this is Montreal, right? Over and over again, the media is using stock shots of our Chinatowns and or of Asian Canadians for headlines where it's just, what do you need to know in Quebec, about COVID. You know, Quebec has no Chinatowns. This is the last Chinatown left. We barely have an Asian population, but this is the image that gets to represent coronavirus in Quebec. So, and this is the kind of thing that translates into our Chinatowns being vandalized, our grandmothers getting spit on in the street, and folks that look, you know, of a certain way, you know, getting told to go back to their own country. Yeah, I mean, like this photo is just, you know, folks doing karate. When we talk about COVID, like what is the correlation, right? I mean, there's a kind of implicit bias that, you know, and the press, I think, has a responsibility.
And I would think that, you know, as more and more people, and I'm not talking about Asian Canadians only, but Indigenous people, BIPOC people enter positions of authority within the media industry, they could create alternate counter images to those that we're most familiar with. And I think Karen is someone, for example, and Arvin are, they're both young people who are trying to do exactly that. Because I when I was growing up, my I had so few, I was exposed to so few images of Asian Canadians, you know, I was very much influenced by stereotypes, whether it be, you know, Hop Sing on Bonanza or, a Lotus Blossom, you know, Asian women in particular. And so I was just craving some alternate narrative about, Asian Canadians. And it really does have an impact on your view of yourself and what you can do and what you're capable of. So I think as more and more people have decision-making power and the ability to present other kinds of images of Asian Canadians, you know, we don't have to start at that base level every time. Seems like we're always moving back to the yellow peril, to the model minority.
And just to add to that, I think as journalists, we need to acknowledge that this is not a new phenomenon, like what both Karen and Pam mentioned, and stop acting like it is every single time. I think learning your history, we need to acknowledge like the long history of anti-Asian racism and coverage. Also, we need to understand, I think, data when reporting. For example, the surge in reported cases of anti-Asian hate like across cities in North America can also mean that like in some cities, a lot of people feel relatively safer to report these cases compared to maybe folks in like smaller towns. Like, I think because there's maybe like a tendency to sensationalize like headlines sometimes, like a lot of Asian people are being hurt or attacked in like this city. And so like people revert to like the baseline of, oh, we need to talk to the Asians who were attacked, but then not understanding that maybe some people are actually more compelled to report cases. And I think what I'm saying is like report with facts and accuracy, show humanity and compassion in your reporting, avoid stereotypes, continue to challenge them. I think journalism, we always hold people in power to account, but we can also hold history and norm and like existing narratives to account as well. We need to question those in order to better the coverage.
Yeah, no, I mean, I completely agree with what you're saying, Arvin. Like, the problem is like when especially when all these kind of violent things come out, it's so, you know, we heard so much about all the hate crimes and all, you know, all these awful things that have happened this year, but leading up to that, and in a way the video that started off this whole discussion is kind of like a capsule of the year and a bit we've lived through, in the sense that it starts with these microaggressions, right? Like these, like where do you come from, like these kind of like, you know, seemingly innocent things, but if we don't look at what's behind that and the kind of context of what allows these kind of this kind of racism to flare up in these moments, right, where a community can be scapegoated. You know, like the media this year has really concentrated on the hate crimes and all of this, but not looking and analyzing the kind of racism that we're experiencing on a systemic level, right? Like looking at why is it 5, 6, 7 generations of you know, Asian folks being in Canada, we still see them as if they just got off the boat from China with some coronavirus, right? Like you know, and you can extrapolate that to folks today. Like, who are we seeing on our front lines? You know, who are the people keeping the food supply chain going and the meatpacking plants? You know, temporary foreign workers, many from the Filipino community, people, you know, the caregivers, all this. And these people have faced the brunt of the coronavirus, you know, like the COVID itself, you know, fear for your health, your safety, your job, but also, you know, facing in the streets real racism. But you know, our reporting doesn't look, you know, what we might look at the woman who got spat on or attacked, but we're not talking about why is it that as a society, as a Canadian society, we're constantly seeing this person as a foreigner and treating them as a less than person, right? It's because of the systemic barriers to citizenship for a lot of folks, or, you know, this kind of lack of telling the story of the contributions of Asians, you know, longstanding contributions, and even like very present contributions in this current crisis that we're living in, right? We don't celebrate that and talk about that as a Canadian narrative.
Exactly. You know, I think, and when you only focus on the microaggressions, the discussion remains at the level of the individual or the individuals involved. And, you know, so what I would really like to see is to, as Karen just pointed out, to talk about systemic racism, about how we have a history of racism. And also, I mean, think about anti-Black racism and anti-Indigenous racism. At the same time that we look at anti-Asian racism, because I think the same sort of societal processes are at work. And these are distinct, for sure, distinct histories, but I think this is the same structural or societal processes are behind or help to perpetuate each form of racism against various different groups within Canada.
Mm-hmm. Right, for sure. And I think like this discussions we have so far is directly the directions I love to go into, which is more the systemic issues beyond, you know, the visceral hate crimes that we have seen over the past year. And then we know that, you know, the rise in anti-Asians or anti-Chinese narrative have been going on even before the coronavirus. And I think, you know, with the rise of China and the fact that we are seeing a lot of Chinese on our headlines, you know, what reporting techniques or framing or language do you think is important to keep in mind when we approach that reporting so that it also doesn't come back and become weaponized to harm Asian Canadians? Maybe we start with Karen.
Yeah, well, I mean, yeah, I think at the very beginning, yeah, I've said it before, but the media did a very poor job of differentiating China, the country, versus Chinese, right? And I mean, the rise of China and all the kind of geopolitics surrounding it influences the way we talk about China and the way China's reported. And, you know, and I'm not going to get into all the details of that, but, you know, it's framed in a certain way. Like there's an example on one of the slides where the New York Times reported, you know, China's response to locking down the country for, you know, COVID versus, and 20 minutes later tweeted about Italy's response. And you can see the two, like, totally different narratives that the New York Times is kind of weaving within 20 minutes of each other. And a lot of it has to do with kind of this implicit bias around, you know, how we see China versus how we see Italy. You know, and none of our little Italies, you know, were stigmatized when, you know, like the COVID was ravaging Italy during the first wave, right? But our Chinatowns were, and it's because of this, you know, this disconnect. I live in Quebec, you know, and every time anyone I would know would raise issue about, you know, violence they were seeing or kind of racist incidents. And then, you know, often you're just, you know, people throw it back in your face. Well, what about, you know, this, the Uyghurs in China? What about the two Michaels? What about all these things, right? And it's, and, you know, on a human rights, like, we can have a separate discussion about all of those things. But the thing is, with a lot of Asian Canadians, I think we've been confronted with, you know, this kind of false equivalency, like the racism and the violence we're experiencing here in Canada often gets thrown back at us. Well, you know, this is kind of payback for what China is doing, you know, to other people else, like, you know. And would we ever ask, I'm from Quebec, so do we ask folks from Quebec to chime in on like what the French government in France is doing to their people? You know, like we never tie them in the same way that it's like, even though we're here, we're in Canada, we're still somehow tied and made to account for and answer for things that are going on in the country of China. So I think that, you know, at a base, I think that was a problem, like the inability to kind of separate those two things.
Yeah, and you know, I think about the internment of Japanese Canadians in relation to what Karen was just saying. I mean, you know, the majority of people who were interned, and many of whom were also deported from this country, were Canadian born. They were Canadian born citizens or naturalized immigrants. And it was just on the basis of their, perceived loyalties, perceptions about on the basis of how someone looked, and, you know, their racial origin, my community was completely dispossessed during the Second World War. And, you know, people like my father and my mother had grown up in this country and really knew nothing about Japan. I mean, my father had been to Japan once when he was about 2 years old. My mother had never been to Japan to this day, and she's now in her 90s. But because she was identified as someone, a Japanese person, not a Canadian of Japanese descent, and therefore as a Japanese person, loyal to the Emperor of Japan, was taken away from her home and lost property, lost friendships, etc. So it's that, again, that perception that we are always foreigners, regardless of citizenship.
Also, I think, Alex, when I was just thinking, when you ask about how can we frame this in terms of reporting, like reporting techniques, I'm just wondering, like, maybe we need to go back to the basics of journalism, just report accurately, report facts, and avoid color that may or may not be rooted in prejudice and how you understand the world, especially for non-BIPOC journalists, because that's a different experience altogether. And then when you write a story and you put your color in there, it may skew and then end up with all these problematic depictions of Asian Canadians.
Well, I would say to counter what Arvind's saying, I guess, and I'm not a journalist, albeit, but I would say rather than avoid color, no color, like understand color, understand the meaning of Blackness, the meaning of being an Asian Canadian, of being an Indigenous person, understand the context in which people live.
Sorry, Pam. Like, I just need to clarify. I meant color not as like race, but color as in colorful language in depictions. Like, so because like colorful language journalism, it's really injecting your opinion and your biases in like the stories you cover. And so when you avoid color, it's just straight facts. And I think it'll be less problematic because, especially in newsrooms right now, where like more people are not BIPOC, like a lot of like working journalists in like high power, they come from different experiences. And so implicitly, like those biases may penetrate like the color commentary that you insert in journalism. So if you avoid that, maybe like it'll lessen the harm to our communities.
Mm-hmm. Right, for sure. And yeah, I think from our discussion so far, I think that regardless of your, whether you're BIPOC or you're not, I think it's just a fundamental thing as journalists to understand the, you know, the history behind the whole thing, you know, that doesn't come in as a point of nowhere, like understand history, understand, you know, what perpetual foreigner means, like, you know, understand what it means when a framing is framing someone as, you know, double loyalty and stuff like that, so that we don't fall prey to actors, like bad faith actors who are pushing these narratives, and really asking these questions. And I think another thing when we talk about, I think as Arvind kind of touch on is, you know, the lack of diversity within newsroom is so sometimes when we do get to talk about Asian Canadians, they get lumped together under this one big umbrella without any, you know, acknowledgement of diversity even amongst the groups. And I guess, you know, like, how do we as journalists make space to cover these different groups and their diverse needs adequately? So, you know, maybe Arvind can touch on this because I know that you're Filipino and Southeast Asian Canadians tend to have maybe different needs than East Asian Canadians, for example.
I think, Alex, you touched on the answer. I think we need to acknowledge the diversity of experiences and the unique challenges within this huge Asian Canadian umbrella that we're all lumped in. I think, again, foundation of journalism, a good journalist will cover the basis, and that's the fact, and will strive to know the difference and capture the nuance of the human experience and like a particular community. And so, yeah, like as you mentioned, I work with Omni Filipino, and we cover a lot of Filipino stories and stories that are important to our community. And I work alongside like teams from different like community groups, and they have they produce their own newscasts. And some days we don't even have like similar stories that we cover because it's so diverse. And we go to the nitty-gritty of like really like important issues in the community. And it doesn't just start and end with a hate crime. It celebrates like triumph. It celebrates like perseverance. It mourns loss. And so, yeah, I think you just have to like understand the nuance and like the diversity of experiences within this big umbrella of Asian Canadian community that we're all like made to fit together.
But I mean, as you mentioned, Arvind, like that's why it's so important to have a diverse, diverse faces, both in front, but behind the cameras even more so, because these are the folks that have the editorial control, right? And it's really understanding a story, not necessarily even from the quote unquote mainstream perspective, right? When you have a different lived experience, when you're a BIPOC person, or when you personally relate to the concept of perpetual foreigner, you know, you bring a different angle to your questioning, right? And to the storytelling and to how we explore something. I mean, thinking back, because I've just watched it recently, but the documentary Who Killed Vincent Chin, right? The Vincent Chin story. At the very beginning, like with the plea bargaining, that they just let these two guys get off, you know, with $3,000, nothing. And I mean, obviously the Asian community came around and started calling for justice, but it was really this moment of investigative journalism that opened the case again, right? The journalists finally start asking the questions, asking the witnesses, like all the stuff that the judge and the whole legal system hadn't done, right? Because you're right, the journalism, we are the fifth estate, you know, you do hold power to account. You have to ask those hard questions and look at an issue not on the surface, right? Like as a documentary filmmaker, I've had the chance to be in lots of different communities that aren't necessarily my own, you know, and something that really hit home with me hard was when I spent time in Chicago's South Side, right? So it's a neighborhood that's always characterized in the media for like gang violence, you know, shootouts, this and that. And then you go there and of, you know, there is this element, but I was walking on the street, you see, you know, the community has no hospitals. The community is so cut up. There's police cameras on the corner, these high tech, you know, super expensive police cameras on the corner to surveil these folks. But when, if someone gets shot, no ambulance shows up, you know, that to me is the story. You know, like, you can talk about gun violence in this, but what about the violence of poverty and the violence of, you know, of being marginalized in your own country, right? So these are the kind of like stories I feel that a diverse news force and diverse storytelling, you know, brings to the fore, right? You get to the second layer, which is just, you know, beyond the kind of, you know, grandma getting spit on at the bus stop story. It's like, what is behind that? Why does that happen in 2021 Canada?
Mm-hmm. Right, for sure. Yeah, I think that's super important, talking about the systemic issue. And I know that, you know, the idea of Asian Canadians and also the idea of model minority, you know, really hides the huge income gap within, you know, Asian Canadians themselves. I don't know if we have data. I know that in the US, that's a lot of data, but in Canada, it's a different story. But, you know, so for example, we see a lot of, you know, Filipino Canadians being disproportionately affected during the coronavirus pandemic because they work on the front line as healthcare workers and personal care workers. I know for a fact that for my Vietnamese community, the first thing I think about with the pandemic is, oh, you know, like, how will these nail salon workers, how would they fare? And so sometimes when we think of Asian Canadians, we don't think about those different intersectionalities within, you know, well, how would it intersect with income or class, or, you know, how would it intersect with sexuality and gender? Because I knew that women are disproportionately affected during this wave of hate crimes. And, you know, like, how as educator and journalist, how do you add intersectionality to your coverage, and how do you want to see others do the same, regardless of whether they are Asian Canadians or not? If someone wants to jump in, Karen?
Okay, yeah. I can go ahead. That's actually, like, I was just thinking about this because Filipinos, at least, like, I'm not speaking for my entire community, because even here, like, I'm not a representative of the entire Filipino Canadian experience. I don't have the perspective of a first gen Filipino Canadian. I moved here from the Philippines in 2009. I think though that in general, like, Filipinos really hold resilience as like kind of like a bragging trait. Like, we always like celebrate how we're resilient in the Philippines, like how we like storm through typhoons and stuff like that. But the thing is, like, I feel like in celebrating resilience, though, we miss questioning the system that requires us to be resilient. And I think a good journalist and a good, like, media practitioner will question the system that requires people to be a certain way, and also will respect the nuance of, like, different identities and understand that in your storytelling coupled with data. And I think that will be like the ingredient of a good journalism, of good journalism and good reportage. So in my work, for example, like, I always strive to understand the context of this person, like their position in a big community, plus their experiences as individuals. And that requires me to just listen every single time, like, listen and do research. And I guess, like, just going back to my point earlier, that's really the basic of journalism, like, of good journalism and good reportage.
Mm-hmm. Right, for sure. Yeah, sometimes I just find it really funny when something is framed as a feel-good story, but really it's an indictment of, like, a failure of a system. A lot of healthcare in the US, but anyway, Karen?
Yeah, well, I mean, from my point of view, I am in a very privileged position now because I've managed to, you know, I am a storyteller, right? And I work as a producer for different TV series or documentaries. So one thing, like, personally that I'm committed to and that I try to bring to every project I do is a race lens and a gendered lens. you know, and I've had the privilege of also working, you know, as much as I've, you know, complained about CBC and some of their news coverage and all of this, I've worked at the NFB, I've worked at, you know, on productions for the CBC, where these organizations have a mandate, right, to have a certain amount of people of color or women storytellers, right, at the fore. And that, I think, is how you change the culture of these certain organizations. But, you know, and also, I mean, myself, obviously, I'm mixed race, right? So from the very first film I did, I actually realized that, you know, I experienced a lot of the privilege that other people don't, right? And even on my first film I did, which was about the Chinese head tax, I remember early in the research going to this kind of debate, because it was a debate at the time in the Chinese community, like, should we even ask for an apology? Like, how dare we, you know, ask the government so many years later for an apology? And I remember thinking, you know, they're having this ongoing debate. Wow, like, half my family was given free farmland to come here because they were white, you know, while the rest of my family was charged this $500 head tax, right? So when you start seeing it from those two sides, it takes on this different meaning, right? Because often within the Chinese community at the time, a lot of the dialogue was like, you know, how dare we speak up about this? We don't have a right. We're here now. We're lucky to be here, all this and that. And then the white side of me was like, oh no, like my Scottish grandfather or my Irish great grandfather would be rotting in some, you know, some potato field somewhere. Yeah, you know, had he not been come here, the same way you say you're so thankful you're not in the rice paddy field, but except for my white family was given a free farm when they arrived, not locked up in the detention center. And, you know, so sometimes that comparison also helps with, you know, getting to a new, more nuanced story, right? Like, I mean, I did a film on women's rights, but I talked about childcare, right? And there was no way I was going to tell that story about childcare without talking about the live-in caregiver program and the Filipino women that basically, you know, shore up this lack of a national childcare system, right? And there was no way I was going to talk about violence against women in Canada without talking about murdered and missing Indigenous women, right? When you bring in these extra nuances of the folks that live at those intersections, those marginalized intersections, that's how you create a full story. Not just a kind of surface level, you know, news story.
And I'm wondering, you know, I think that the responsibility needs to fall on everyone's shoulders, because we have the Arvins and Karens, but limited in number. And it can't fall on certain individuals only. And I'm thinking that, you know, we have to find a way of making this the responsibility of those who also are not, you know, visibly racialized people or are not Indigenous people. I mean, it can't only, I think, you know, what people, especially young people within the broad Asian community have done is exceptional. And I'm wondering how we can go beyond that so that the onus is on others as well. And I also think that there's a backlash, a very strong backlash against people who are racialized, who stand up and try to make a change. It doesn't come without its costs and, you're scrutinized constantly for what you're doing. And sometimes even, you know, sort of silence or censor yourself at times because of the fear of that backlash. And I don't know, I mean, it may be something that, I don't want to lump all Asians as one, or, you know, consider all Vietnamese, people of Vietnamese origin or Filipino as one. I mean, and just thinking about your question about intersectionality. I mean, I think it's really important that we think about the ways in which racialized women face different kinds of barriers and impediments than racialized men.
Yeah, I think it's so important for newsrooms, you know, not think about covering Asian story as like filling a quota, like just because you touched on one Asian group doesn't mean like you're done for today. You have to think about different groups within the umbrella as well. And, you know, like make intersectionality a central framing, I guess, a central, I guess not just like a nice to have, but a need to have in terms of a tools of investigating. And I think like it just makes for a better journalist. So I don't think there's any, you know, downside to having a better incorporations of that technique into your journalism. And you know, like this discussion so far also kind of points toward that sense of once again, the lack of diversity within newsrooms. And, you know, I guess from your own personal experiences, have you faced, you know, challenges in newsroom and academia where, you know, coverage of Asian Canadians is not welcome until it's Asian Heritage Month or when, or until, you know, hate crimes happen? And if yes, like how have you responded to that tokenizations and, you know, like what can we do collectively to change it?
Well, I mean, I will say that this is probably one of the first Asian Heritage Months where folks aren't only concentrating on, you know, singing and dancing and food, you know, like we're trying to have like actual discussions around race and belonging and really staking our place in the history and the present of the country. So I think that that's a good thing. Personally, I mean, I work in a space where like I've kind of crafted this voice where I'm talking often from these kind of marginalized positions where I'm trying to put forward those stories. But I mean, even I'm working on a film on disappearing Chinatowns right now. And you know, and trying to pitch the film to broadcasters and stuff, it was amazing. You know, you see the kind of culture of the broadcaster. You know, we pitched one broadcaster and the story, part of the story is like Montreal is the last Chinatown left in Quebec, right? It's like 140-year-old neighborhood, you know, like it's a very, and it tells a story of the history of Montreal. And I was told in a meeting to a broadcaster, Quebec broadcaster, and I won't name them, where I told them this whole thing and they told me that it wasn't a Quebec story, right? Like this idea that your own history in your own place is not a quote unquote Canadian or Quebec story, you know? So this idea of the stories we told being kind of put to the side, that this is the kind of obstacles I've encountered.
I've always seen Asian Heritage Month as a time not to celebrate the resilience of Asian Canadians in the face of you know, race, that very blatant, often very blatant racism and more nuanced forms of racism. So to me, it's never been simply a celebration of the successes of very, by traditional measures, successful Asians. It's been about the way in which the communities have evolved over time, including the many barriers and challenges that they faced. And this year, yes, as Karen said, it's been a very different kind of Asian Heritage Month. It's been an extremely busy one, but also really gratifying in that I'm seeing more and more Asian Canadians, whether they be of Japanese descent, Chinese, Vietnamese, come together and embrace their identity. And you know, it's a very complex and for some groups a very sort of fractured identity, but come together and talk about their experiences. And you know, and it's not just those who are in the public eye or you know, leaders or you know, journalists. It's regular people within organizations. You know, at Ryerson, we always have an Asian Heritage Month celebration. And out of all of this now has grown a group of staff and faculty who are of Asian descent, who want to join forces and stand up against racist treatment and, you know, the misrepresentation or the invisibility of people of Asian descent in the media. So it's been a very difficult time, but at the same time, extremely promising, a hopeful one.
Yeah, and I guess, you know, if media executives or newsroom leaders is in this panel, please make space for more Asian stories beyond just Asian Heritage Month for when, you know, violent crimes happen, because it is so important. So that's my one call to arms based on the discussion so far. I think it's so important as we have these discussions that we acknowledge that the conversations and effort to push for more newsroom diversity or, you know, against anti-Asian racism doesn't just happen in a vacuum. And, you know, with last summer protests for, George Floyd protests, and also the ongoing push from Indigenous journalists to have more representations. How do we learn from Black and Indigenous journalists and educators? How can we better build solidarity with them in this ongoing effort to diversify and tell better stories and represent? Maybe we can start with Pam.
Well, what I've tried to do, I know I'm in a very privileged position. And so I've tried to use any kind of resources or power that I have to support anti-Black efforts to combat anti-Black racism, efforts to combat anti-Indigenous racism. And, I've been extremely supportive of Indigenous education, hiring more Indigenous faculty members. I can do that because I'm in this position, and I think it's my responsibility actually in this position to take a stand and then to set an example and to be able to help to facilitate the success of people who may not have had the exact same experiences as I do as an Asian Canadian, but to have faced, I don't want to even compare. I mean, years of oppression, years of centuries of colonialism. I think that taking advantage of your privileged position to be able to support those kinds of initiatives is just important to me. And it's one of the reasons I do what I do. That's most satisfying, to be able to build those alliances. That's just part of, and I'm not speaking on behalf of all Asian Canadians, but I think it's part of my set of values. It's just part of who I am because of what's happened to me. And, you know, those years when I was called all sorts of names, less frequently, but still get called racist names. I feel that I'm going to build alliances with other groups who have faced these kinds of experiences.
Yeah, no, I think it's really important, as Asians in the media or as Asians, as a group, like building solidarity and showing up and coming out for other groups is very important, right? Like, if you want people to recognize the racism and violence you're facing, you have to show up for their communities as well. And I mean, for us as Asians, like, the model minority is a real kind of central thing to the kind of stereotyping around our community. But it's also, we have to recognize how it's used as a tool to pit us against other marginalized folks, right? To stand us up as this kind of model of, why can't you just put your head down, work hard, and then you won't have any problems, right? Whether, all the myths around that, but it's a way of really dividing our community with, folks in the Black community or the Aboriginal community, when we really should be coming around a shared sense of, we don't have the same kind of oppressions, or we don't experience racism in the same ways, but there's a baseline for wanting to fight for, human rights and equality, where we need to stand up and find the kind of commonalities and link our struggles and the things we're going to other folks who are also, marginalized in different ways, and also to tell their stories and to, push up their points of view on a certain topic in the stories that we ourselves tell.
And really, like, I will not add anything, but I just want to echo Pam and Karen's points, but like also, no, I will add something. I also want to say that as like, for example, like as a Filipino journalist, I always try to be mindful of the space I take as well on when to speak up and also when to sit back and listen. Because yeah, like as Karen mentioned, like you really need to, like sometimes all you have to do is just be there, be like a presence of support and let the people tell their stories. And you just use your platform to like really uplift the voices.
Right, for sure. So I guess, you know, when we talked earlier about understanding the history and the framing and the narrative, we need to do the same for other communities as well. And use that as a way to, you know, not just uplift our own community, but understand that how, you know, structure or systemic racism has also used a community to pit each other against, you know, real progress. So yeah, and I think with that, you know, discussions and context so far, how would you, as journalist and educator, what would your, you know, takeaway, a call to arms around anti-Asian racism and journalism, you know, whether it be in the newsroom or even earlier in the classroom with, you know, journalism school and all of that? So maybe we can start with Karen this time.
Well, yeah, I mean, my call to arms, don't just tell the story, work to change the story, ask those hard questions, make some deeper connections and try to bring a different layer to the analysis on what's going on. That's what I would say for the news tellers and the news absorbers. I would say for the audiences, you know, question the news you're receiving, right? We're in a moment of, you know, social media, this and that, where everyone's in their own echo chamber, and kind of racist attitudes and disinformation can travel very far and very fast. So you really have to be very critical about what you see and try to, you know, find other sources where the same story is maybe being told from a different person's angle.
I guess I would say that, like Karen, we're in a moment, and I would say take advantage of that, this moment, because it's going to pass. It will for sure pass. And this is a time when, you know, discussion of racism is on the table, so to speak. And so I'm taking advantage of every opportunity to talk about ways in which we can address and attack and combat anti-Asian, anti-Indigenous, anti-Black, and other forms of racism. And I think there's also going to be a backlash. I can already see it emerging, you know, and in social media, also in the, you know, I've been listening to a lot of comedy recently, stand-up comedy, and you know, people are ridiculing cancel culture. I mean, and not understanding the reasons behind that movement, that you know, social phenomenon, cancel culture. And, you know, again, just sort of taking a very superficial look at what's going on in society now. So I think really important to be aware of this backlash. And I think, you know, it's still in some circles very acceptable to make racist comments against Asians. And perhaps, you know, more accessible than to make other kinds of racist comments. And I think that model minority myth probably feeds into it. And, you know, especially in the US, but certainly Canada as well. So I think, you know, always be aware and take advantage and aggressively attack racism now.
And just to add to that, I think I'm just gonna share the story. Last year, my peers and I wrote calls to action addressed to our journalism school that we attended. And we provided ways to assist and help BIPOC students going through the journalism program of the institution, because these people will be like the storytellers of this country. Like a lot of them will end up like as journalists framing narratives. And so some BIPOC students, like they decide to like not continue the program because they just feel unsafe there. And so we detailed ways on how to like improve the environment, and also how non-BIPOC students can learn so that they'll be better journalists as well. And so I think, but most of us are still starting our careers, we're in precarious positions. So we really felt that we were putting our names and reputations on the line. And I think that's also when stuff like this comes up, I think the onus is to the institutions to realize that when students and when BIPOC people speak up, it's rarely coming from like ill intentions. Most of the time, BIPOC speak up because we care about the institution. We know the potential of the institution to do better. And so I think as much as we need to support each other, we need the support of organizations and institutions to know that a lot of this, a lot of the fight comes from a good place. And it's not to really dismantle them or burn their places to the ground, but like it's to assist them, giving them the opportunity to do better. Because I don't know, like maybe like it's naive, like optimism, because we believe that they can do better.
And just to add to what Arvin said, I think maybe, it's important to, then to rethink the profession, rethink the fundamental tenets of the profession. I mean, maybe, you know, there's this perception that in order to be a leader, whether it be a successful journalist or an academic, you have to have a really thick skin, just take it. And, you know, why? I mean, why do we have to do that? No, you can assert yourself and talk about your identity, and you know that should be part of, in my view, being an academic or being a journalist.
And I'm just to add to that, when one of my first internships, like years back, I struggled telling a story because I was being, quote, emotional about it, because I just felt that I really identified. But my boss at the time like really told me that, and it's stuck to this day, that good reporters feel. You should not be detached from your emotions, but good reporters feel, but good reporters also report on facts and accuracy. Like be accurate, feel. Like you're human beings after all, like, you know, like, do not like let this like illusion of like objectivity and a view of like from nowhere, because that's a point of view of someone, to like cloud and really limit the journalism you want to do. Because again, good reporters feel.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, for sure. Thank you so much for all these really great points. And I think, you know, the whole point about having a thick skin, sometimes ignore the fact that racialized women journalists tend to disproportionately receive more harassment and, you know, hate mails and all that stuff. And that's another whole discussion that we need to have in terms of supporting racialized journalists in these conversations. But I think that's why it's so important to be maybe rethink that narrative as well. And if it's possible, here are some ideas I have as well. You know, it's so important to just not prioritize talking about anti-Haitian hate crimes when there are, you know, violent crimes happening, but also understanding, you know, looking at why are there no data about, you know, coronavirus impact on Asians, or where are those health data? So sometimes it's those systemic thing that we don't think about as racism, but they more likely to impact much more of our community than, you know, hate crimes, regardless of how physical and how, you know, violent they are. And I think we need to put our mind around that, and that will help a lot more people. And I think the second thing is, you know, given the history and discussions that we're still having, you know, this conversation around racism will be ongoing for a very long time. So, you know, take care of yourself, and support each other, because it's not a sprint, it's a marathon. We'll probably likely have another conversations around anti-Asian racism in the future. So definitely don't, you know, lose interest tomorrow or the next month. We need to be constantly working on this issue and to support each other. And so, yeah, I think that is the end of our panel discussions. And now we'll open it up to the audience questions. There are a bunch of them. So I have received, there are so many. Sorry, I'm just trying to get some questions. This is no, in particular, no order, but, you know, questions from the audience. My sense is that in the US, the term Asian, it's generally understood to refer to East and Southeast Asian people, whereas in the UK, it is generally understood to refer to South Asian people. How do you think the term Asian is understood in Canada? Do you think racism against East and Southeast Asian Canadians and racism against South Asian Canadian is similar enough to be usefully covered by a single term? And this is by Akash Maharaj. Sorry if I mispronounced that. But yeah, so that's the first audience question. Shall we start with maybe Pam?
So I would say that anyone who identifies in these categories, who wants to join a conversation, identifies as something, I would be as inclusive as possible, and not to deny the differences between these groups, but I, in organizing against anti-Asian racism, I would include all groups. There should be a very broad base. So I would include those who identify as South Asian, East Asian, et cetera. I mean, that's my thinking around this issue. Yeah.
I find it a really interesting conversation, because I was like in a meeting this week, and the government is trying to kind of come up with a, you know, definition of Asian in terms of like anti-Asian racism. And you know, the term Asian is very broad, right? Like it literally, like the continent of, you know, it's from Turkey to the Middle East to Japan to, you know, like you could argue the aftermath of 9/11, you know, Sikhs, what happened to Sikh folks, Middle Eastern folks, you know, all this kind of reporting about honor killings and forced marriages, like this is a component of the Asian community. I mean, in Canada, in a way, because I think historically, the Japanese and the Chinese are the Asian communities that have the deepest roots in Canada, we tend to think of Asians in Canada as like an East Asian bloc. But it's a problematic, because Asian, it encompasses so much and it erases and flattens out the experiences of other folks, you know, folks from Filipino community, from South Asian community, who experience racism as well, maybe in different ways. And especially when you're talking about model minority and you know, like crazy rich Asians or you know, these kind of stereotypes, it's not necessarily folks from these other non-East Asian groups that come to mind, you know? So we have to be cognizant of, like, it's a real blanket term, but like bringing that nuance to the stories and when we're discussing anti-Asian racism, really kind of looking at how it breaks down in different groups.
Yeah, I think like the conversation said, it's, you know, I think it's a useful term for solidarity, but when it comes to critical analysis, they flattened and we need to really dig into the different ethnicities and groups. And I know, as Karen mentioned, I know that a lot of South Asians experience racism in a different way, especially after 9/11, than East Asians and Southeast Asian do. So I think it's so important to just not kind of think of it as a common block and disregard the nuances there, because it doesn't serve anyone. All right, on to the next question. So during last summer resurgence of the Black Lives Matter movement, I saw discourse online about the concept of Black Joy too, or the importance of covering positive stories about Black lives alongside stories about trauma and systemic racism. Do you think there is room for that concept about the media's coverage of Canada's various Asian communities? Shall we start with RV?
Oh, Arvin, you're on mute. Yeah.
I realized. Sorry. I think, of course, like there's always like room for joy. I think like I'm just very fortunate right now with all the reporting I do because I work for a community like oriented show. If we just cover hate crimes, like abuse that our community or like the Filipino community experience, like we will not have a show tomorrow. You know what I mean? Like we need to like really like explore different facets of like what it is and what makes like Filipino Canadian like life today. And but the thing with joy though, like I think a lot of members of the BIPOC communities, we tend to make light of the misery that we experience. And as the old adage goes, like misery loves company. Like my friends and I, like when we experience like, oh my gosh, like was that a microaggression or a racism? We tend to like gather together and make light of the situation, but it's still not okay. But at the same time, like it is kind of a weapon to get by because you know that like someone understands. And so I think we also need to have space in our media landscape to really like cover stories like that, cover stories of friendship, cover stories of like BIPOC helping each other, community like uplifting each other, because I think everyone can use it. Like it's just too much, like seeing people who look like us, our bodies being brutalized, like experiencing violence, and not see like that on the flip side, most of us turn all this violence and hate into like jokes, into joy in our own circles to really like get by.
I mean, I think it's important, like the celebration part, it's fundamental. It's like that adage, like you can't be what you can't see, right? Like we need to celebrate our own heroes and our own narrative of resilience and resistance, you know, being here. And sometimes it comes from those dark places, like overcoming obstacles or hardship. But like, I remember the first film I did on the head tax, like discovering that history for the very first time because I never learned it in school, right? And it's a really dark and awful racist moment. But out of that, I found Chinese Canadian heroes, right? That fed my soul and made me realize that I am Canadian, like through and through, no matter how many people tell like the fifth generation of my family to go back to their country, right? So it's like you can take, you know, like the civil rights movement came out of awful racism, right? But you get a hero out of that and you get the hope and you get, you know, you get this kind of community story of resilience. So, you know, I think anger is a great place to start with your storytelling and your, you know, you find those amazing hopeful stories sometimes in the darkest places.
Yeah, I completely agree. You know, I'm also an oral historian and particularly interested in the lives of working people, you know, with a focus on working women, racialized women. And, you know, in my experience, when I ask people about, you know, experiences of racism, discrimination, I don't get too much of a response, but I ask them about their lives as a whole. And then at the same time that they talk about a horrible incident of racism, whether or not they define it that way, they will talk about the joys in life. And, you know, I think it's important to consider people in you know, the many dimensions of their lives. So I think that's a great idea.
Yeah, I agree with everyone here, because I think that writing about just trauma veers into trauma porn, and it kind of makes a caricature of the human experience. The next questions: what do you see as media responsibility and role to protect Canada's core values of multiculturalism, diversity, and equality? How do we hold the media responsible for using stigmatizing language against Asian Canadians in order to sell news? Maybe you can start with Karen.
Yeah, that's hard. I mean, I would challenge in a way, like whether or not our values are like quote unquote multiculturalism. Like this is like the cynical side of me. But yeah, I mean, I don't know, like people that were talking about, like, do we need a kind of media watchdog to kind of, you know, articulate when this kind of, you know, a stereotypical racist language comes up, you know? I don't know. I think it might be useful. I would like to think that the institutions themselves would have a kind of checks and balances for those kind of thing, like looking for the bias in the kind of photos they're sticking up to certain things or the kind of headlines they're saying, you know. But I mean, I come also from Quebec and you were the Charter of Quebec values and all these kind of words about you know, whose values are Canadian or, you know, so I'm always a little cautious about values. Like to me, I think a big reckoning also in Canada is we need to recognize that racism is kind of like a Canadian value, not one that we want to keep. But it's kind of one that this country was based on, racism and colonialism. So, you know, we like to dress it in this multicultural mosaic stuff, which is okay, but we really got to get deeper than that. And because, you know, we pretend we're multicultural in this and that, but it erases some of the real systemic things that need to get addressed.
I would say that the media, and not the media alone, like all institutions within this country have a responsibility to represent Canada as it really is. So I think that, and racism is a part of Canadian history. It's you know, both past and present. So I think that is the responsibility. And I guess I would add to represent all people within Canada. You know, the diverse experiences within this country.
Once again, hi. So I think we are out of time. And I see that we still have a lot of questions. So obviously that's a sign that we need to continue to have more conversations around this topic in the future, regardless of whether it's Asian Heritage Month or not. Thank you so much for the CRRF for facilitating this space to have these conversations. And thank you so much to everyone for attending. But yeah, I think that is it for our panel discussion today.
Thank you.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Teresa, you can close out for us.
There, okay. So I would like to thank all our esteemed panelists, Karen, Pam, and Irvin, for sharing their perspectives and thoughts this afternoon, from how media can perpetuate racial biases as well as changing the narratives, the need for critical examinations of current practices and real systemic change. So much to talk about and continue to explore and understand. I hope that we'll have opportunities in the future to hear responses from the Canadian media as well. I would like to echo your observation about this year's Asian Heritage Month. As someone who have been involved in organizing Asian Heritage Month for 20 years, it's been an most emotional year. And I agree that it seems like a year of opening a new chapter. With that reckoning and re-reckoning on issues of identity, belonging, and social justice. We want to thank you, our audience, for your participation. Before we go, we would like to show you an inspiring video produced by the Chinese Canadian National Council for Social Justice called Eyes Open, an anti-Asian racism PSA. Have a great weekend, everyone. Thank you for joining us today.
We have never been loud people. Our elders always taught us that actions speak louder than words, so we learn to keep our heads down, keep our grades up, keep our kin close, keep our mouths shut. I wonder, What it does to a people when they stay quiet for so long, do they forget their voice? The sound of their stories, the resilience of language? When you are no longer in your motherland, does your mother tongue still sing of home? What work songs lifted our spirits as we built the railroad? What prayers did we whisper as they sent us to camps in the mountains to meditate on all the ways we don't belong to this country? So we stayed quiet. As they burned our Chinatowns down and spit on our grandmas at bus stops, we stayed quiet. As they laughed in our faces and told us to go back where we came from, but they've mistaken our silence for compliance. Looked on our meekness as weakness. See, we, and not the submissive stereotype that's been depicted, on silence, on us, they've gotten it twisted. See, silence is golden, as are we. A gradient of yellow to brown, every Koreatown and Little Saigon an act of defiance, every hunchback elder a humble giant. Silence is grace in the triumph, is peace in the riot. Silence is bold, a force. It is the brewing calm before the coming storm, and now the sky is splitting open and the rage is pouring forth, so this is for every kid who has ever tried to pull their nose bridge to make it taller. Every time they mocked us because our eyes are smaller, this is for our elders both alive and remembered, for their lessons, the tough and the tender, for our full names, past and present, may they be pronounced, may they be respected, for every chink in the national fabric, every nip in the winter wind of prairie towns and northern hamlets coast to coast on stolen land. We are here. We've been here. From takeout joints and internment camps to internships and graduation caps, we are strong. We have pride, we fight, we fall, we rise. And to the ones who say we don't belong, it's them who should open their eyes.